A lot of boards, volunteers, when they serve on a board, they bring a lot of experience and expertise in their field, in their domain. Uh-huh. So they're, you know, they understand the technical elements of the work that they do. And they often want to really roll up their sleeves and get hands-on with kind of the implementation. And what your society needs from you as a board is not that. There's staff there to do that. What they need you there for is to share, where are we going as an organization? How do we as a society best serve our members? If you're focusing on operational issues, which is what your CEO is also doing, who's focusing on strategy?
Hi everyone, welcome to another episode of the Strategic Nonprofit Podcast. I'm your host, Trista McIver, and today we'll be going to be talking about strategic planning, including the intricacies of developing and monitoring a plan within your organization. We know that now is the time for most organizations to review their strategic plans. As the world has evolved fast over the past couple years and continues to evolve, a plan from pre-pandemic or even during the pandemic era might not be relevant anymore. So if you feel like now is the time to start looking at your strategic plan again and to start planning for your future, this episode is for you. To explore the topic further, I'm thrilled to have with us today the CEO of AMC MPO Solutions, Tom Abbott. Thanks for joining us on the podcast today, Tom.
Well, Trista, thanks for having me. I am really excited to talk about all things strategic planning. I love this topic. To me, this is the be-all and end-all of organizations, so I'm thrilled to jump right in.
Excellent. So let's just start from the very beginning. Mm. Whose responsibility is it to create the strategic plan?
Yeah, well, the short answer is it's the board. The board is responsible for developing, creating, thinking about, articulating, envisioning the strategic plan. Mm-hmm. So the reason why I emphasize that is because some frameworks, some models, like the Carver model, for example, actually puts the responsibility of developing the strategic plan in the hands of the chief staff officer, the CEO, or the executive director. The board delegates that task to the CEO. I feel like that's a huge mistake for a few reasons. Number one is actually legal liability. In fact, the board of directors is legally responsible for both the management and the governance of the organization, which means they are responsible for the direction that the organization goes. Thus, they need to actually develop the strategic plan. In the absence of that, a lot of boards even feel like, well, what am I even doing here? What's the reason for me to sit on this board if all I'm doing is reviewing reports from the ED? I want to be involved in some way, not in the operation or the administration, but I want to be involved in formulating the plan. Like, what are we here for? Draw upon my expertise and my knowledge. Let me give back. So that's what boards need to be doing, is to actually provide their insights into the direction that the organization, the society needs to go. So it's the responsibility of the board to develop the strategic plan, not the implementation, the operational plan, which is very different, but the big picture strategic plan.
Yeah, this is what I really like about our complementary model, is the coordination and working together of the executive director, CEO, and the board together to work on and develop a strategic plan.
Well, and I like what you say, Trista, about work together,
yeah.
Right? So some people say, oh, well, wait a minute. So are you suggesting that the ED has no role to play in the strat plan? No seat at the table, no voice? No, I'm not suggesting that at all. In fact, the CEO should be, and senior management, so not just the CEO, but if it's a larger organization and your NPO has some senior staff, you know, a director of this or a director of that or a manager of this service or this program, invite them to contribute and participate in the discussion with the board. Absolutely. However, the ultimate decision as to what those strategic goals and objectives are lies with the board. The board approves that strategic plan. The buck stops with them. So definitely, we say the roles, it's complementary. So we need to get the CEO to participate in that because, and senior management, they have boots on the ground. They know what's going on. They can really provide a lot of useful information. So they should be part of the discussion, but the decision as to where we go as a society rests solely, squarely on the shoulders of the board.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So with that, how do they start? How would you start? What are some steps that they can take, an organization can take, to create a strategic plan?
How do we get going?
Right? Yeah. How do we start?
So basically how we get going is it starts with the board making a commitment to, you know what, I think it's time for a strat planning session. Let's do this. It may have been 2, 3, 4, maybe more years since they've looked at their strategic plan, and it's about time. If we've learned anything over the last 2 or 3 years is that strategic planning never planned for this, right? So it's important to kind of dust off that strategic plan. And, you know, similar, we did a podcast on bylaws. And no one wants to look at their bylaws, and yet they should, you know, every 2 or 3 years, just to make sure that they're up to date and nomenclature is current and there's not, you know, any terms that are, you know, outdated. But that's another podcast episode. Link in the show notes. But anyhow, same thing with your strategic plan. We want to make sure that we're moving in the right direction and have our goals changed at all. And they probably have in terms of how we're going to get things done or perhaps what we should be doing. So there needs to be commitment on the part of the board to at least, you know, revisit this plan and then carve out some time. Set aside some time to meet, preferably in person if you can, if you're comfortable with that, but virtually, hybrid works as well. But carve out the time to actually meet, to go through the work. 1, 2, 3 days sometimes, but I think two is just nice, to really come up with something that you all feel good about as a board. And then come up with some clear outcomes, which I can talk about in a moment, some clear outcomes. How will we know that this strategic planning session was in fact successful?
Absolutely. Now, I know with an organization that I was talking with, they actually achieved their goal, their mission. They achieved their mission.
Done.
And yeah, exactly. And so they needed to revisit their mission and their vision because everything didn't
we
fall.
Did it.
They didn't. Yeah. Exactly.
What are
nothing
we
falls
do?
Together.
What are we going to do next quarter? I don't know. Let's figure something out.
Yeah, and I know that's what it is. That's the first step.
Right. Okay. So let's talk about kind of the what are the outcomes that would be achieved as a result of a strategic planning session? Yeah. Well, the first thing that you'll want to, and this is how you know that the strat planning session was successful. Number one is you would reaffirm the mission of the organization. So by reaffirm, we mean, is this what we're here for? Is this the big picture objective? So you want to look at your vision and your mission for the society. What's our reason for existing? What's our purpose? Now, sometimes at some strat planning sessions, this could take, you know, 10, 15 minutes, where you look at your mission statement. You know, usually you check out the website because you're like, oh, I haven't seen this in a while. And you check out your website and go, that seems about right. Yep, we're all good. You know, all in favor, perfect, let's move on. Sometimes we'll work with a board that goes, wait a minute, let's just not move too quickly here. This says empower. I think it should say enable. And then someone goes, that's the same thing. But then someone else goes, you know what? There's a distinction between those two. Let's flesh this out for a couple of hours. And sometimes that's what happens. And there's nothing wrong with that. In fact, I remember working with one organization where the CEO said, can we just quickly kind of go through the mission and vision and just kind of move on to the meat, right? The meat and potatoes. Let's get to the setting of the strategic goals. And I said, definitely. And I have to see what direction your board wants to go. It's not my strat planning session. It's not my agenda. And it's not yours, CEO. It's not yours. It's the board's. Where do they want to go? Now, I'll do my best to make sure that we can kind of stay on track, but I have to follow the appetite of the board. And what ended up happening was that we spent a couple of hours looking at the mission statement, which everyone, the CEO included afterwards, says, you know what? I'm glad we spent the time there. because we needed everybody at the table to feel like, yes, this is our purpose. This is who our stakeholders are. This is who our community is. This is what we're trying to achieve. This is how we'll know we're successful at the end of the day, right? This is what we're aspiring towards. So number one is you want to reaffirm the vision and the mission. Number two is you want to set some clear goals, strategic goals that are consistent with that vision and mission. I would recommend maybe 3 to 5 goals. Some groups get overly ambitious and they've come up with this huge shopping list of 10 different, this is what we're gonna do in 2022 or 2023. And you're like, really? That's not gonna happen. Yeah. Like, you don't have the resources for it. Now, I don't want to stifle creativity or, you know, poo-poo an idea. But what I'm really looking at is saying, wait a minute. You can't set 10 different big picture goals because how are you going to monitor them? How do you make sure you've got the resources to actually achieve those things? So try to be a little bit more realistic, dare I say, and set 3 to 5 big picture strategic goals. Now, once you've done that, then you want to set 3 to 5 smaller, bite-sized, manageable objectives that will then lead towards achieving those goals. So these are the first 3 things every board needs to do, and most boards do these really well. We've hit the vision and mission, we've set the goals and the objectives, and we're done.
Let's put it on the shelf.
Right. We'll see this in 2 years. Yeah. So here's where a lot of boards go wrong. What we want to do is make sure that nobody leaves that room. You got to barricade the doors. Nobody leaves the room until you've done the next 3 things. So the first of those last 3, which is number 4, is to identify, okay, so who's going to do what? So make sure that you've identified who is responsible for, who's accountable for making sure that those programs get developed, that those initiatives get undertaken, etc. Whose name gets put beside? Action by whom? Okay, so that's number 4. Number 5 is action by when? Set some timelines. When do we need to achieve those goals? So how do we know that we're on track, that we're moving forward, that we're on target? And then number 6 is you wanna establish monitoring mechanisms to oversee the work on the strategic plan. So this is where we start getting into implementation. So the board does the formulation of the big picture strategic plan, then hands over that plan to the CEO to then flush it out and to come up with an operational plan or an implementation plan. Here's how I'm gonna get that done. Here are the internal resources that I need in order to make it happen. Here might be a CEO working committee or 2 or 3 or 4 that I will strike in order to achieve those goals. Here's the budget board that I need in order to achieve those goals. So they would have a draft budget that they would then put to the board for review and approval or disapproval. It could be rejected by the board. The board is responsible for establishing the strategic plan and the operational budget. They approve the budget for the organization. With advisement and recommendation, a draft budget, of course, coming from the CEO. They know the ins and outs and the nuts and bolts. But they would come up with that operational plan, and then the board would approve that final strategic plan. So, overseeing the work, organizational effectiveness, monitoring that, is a critical role of the board, which can take place in the form of a CEO report, right? So the ED report or the CEO report that could be every month, every 2 months, or every quarter, at the discretion of the board. The board determines how frequently they should get that report. There could be committee reports as well, which can give updates on how we're moving towards implementing the plan, as well as the financial report gives us indications as to, are we on budget? Is there a variance? If so, why? And then finally, if needed, sometimes an external third-party report to assess or audit or monitor certain programs or policies. So those are the 4 monitoring mechanisms available to a board to ensure, to look at organizational effectiveness and to make sure that we're on track with the strategic plan.
Absolutely.
I think I mumbled strategic plan 2 or 3 times, but the strategic plan. Yes.
Well, that's great. And I really love our last 3 parts of our steps that we do. A lot of organizations that I talk with, they really appreciate that we take the time to be able to, you know, make it happen, not just have the wonderful goals and objectives and have them sit on the shelf. But the EDs really like the monitoring part of it. And so what, like whose responsibility really is it to monitor the implementation of the strategic plan?
Right, so that's a great question, Trista. So just big picture, we're looking at, you know, this idea of monitoring organizational performance or monitoring organizational effectiveness. How are we doing as a society in terms of reaching our organizational goals, being the strategic goals or implementing that strat plan? Who's responsible for monitoring? It's a shared responsibility, the board and the CEO. So the board and the CEO are both responsible for monitoring. Of course, the CEO monitors every day, right? They're involved day to day, boots on the ground, they've got skin in the game, they're there, they know what's happening day in, day out. So they need to be monitoring these things, as well as the board. The board also has to monitor, that's just part of their responsibility as directors. So it's a shared function, and the best way to have the monitoring happen would be through the CEO report, which would be provided again, you know, every month, every 2 months, or every quarter.
Right.
Yeah. Right. But a shared responsibility, both the board and the ED, CEO, have a part to play. They complement each other, and they have to work together on making sure that the organization is moving in the right direction.
Yes, absolutely. So, Tom, what would you like to touch on that we haven't sort of touched on yet? Any final words?
I would say as final thoughts is...
Final thoughts?
Yeah, just remember that your number one responsibility as a board is to set the course for the organization. That is your number one role. A lot of boards, volunteers, when they serve on a board, they bring a lot of experience and expertise in their field, in their domain. So they're, you know, they understand the technical elements of the work that they do. And they often want to really roll up their sleeves and get hands-on with kind of the implementation. And what your society needs from you as a board is not that. There's staff there to do that. What they need you there for is to share, where are we going as an organization? How do we as a society best serve our members? What should we be doing? And thinking strategically, like 30,000 feet. If you picture an airplane, you're up there at 30,000 feet. That's where your board needs to be. If there's one big concern that I hear, the biggest complaint, for lack of a better term, from CEOs, is they feel that their board is too much in the weeds, too much on the ground, getting involved in operational issues. If you're focusing on operational issues, which is what your CEO is also doing, who's focusing on strategy? That's supposed to be you. Board needs to focus on the strategy, 30,000 feet, committees, 15 to 20,000 feet, and leave the boots on the ground, on the runway, on the tarmac. That is for the staff. So focus on big picture strategy, and that's going to provide the clarity and the direction that your society desperately needs.
I love the analogy of the 30,000 feet. It really gives a good perspective of where a board needs to be, looking at the big picture, kind of looking down on what's going on. And yeah, staying out of those operational.
Yeah, bird's eye view. Yeah, you need a bird's eye holistic view of what's happening in the industry, what's happening out there, and what do we as a society need to be doing to serve our members, to serve our members.
Absolutely. Well, thanks again, Tom, for joining us on the podcast today.
My pleasure.
See you again.
Thanks.
If your organization loses focus only a few months into the year, your annual plan might be unrealistic. Set the course for success and engage AMC to facilitate your annual planning session and give the participants a concrete statement on what the organization needs to achieve, including how and when. Our skilled strategic planning facilitators are ready to take your organization to that next level. Contact us today to conduct an annual strategic planning session that creates a brighter future for your board and staff. Simply click the link in the description or head over to our website, AMC MPO Solutions, Strategic Planning, to get started.